My name is Jeffrey Engel. I have the honor of directing the Center for Presidential History, which means I have the honor of doing something really fun tonight, which is introducing one of our colleagues and good friends. But first, we have some rigmarole to get through. In addition to this speech tonight, we also have some exciting things coming up, including I'd like to draw your attention to a really exciting event that we have coming up next month in conjunction with the Dallas Theater Center for their production of LBJ's All the Way. We're having two nights of festivities. The first is a lecture here by one of the leading scholars of LBJ, Julian Zelizer from Princeton University, who just came out with a fascinating new book on the Great Society. And he will be presenting here on Thursday, March 17th. And then the next night, we have the Center for Presidential History night at the Dallas Theater Center. And so you will all be getting an email with a link that will give you not only preferred seating, but also a discount. So, you know, discounts are good. So, okay. That'll be a very exciting event indeed. And I also like to draw your attention to something which our good friends and partners over at the Bush Library, thank you, Alan, for coming, have arranged, including with our fellow, Hervey Pretty over there, who have put together a really marvelous exhibit on presidents and their elections, because you may have heard there's something coming up that might be similar to that. You can go and see some of the wonderful historic collections of posters that we have, and also design your own presidential campaign. I myself am trying to decide if I'm going to run as a socialist or a reality TV star. So, or maybe both. So, but tonight, we have a particular pleasure, and that is to listen to one of our colleagues present on his work on Senator McGovern. Tom Nock first came to SMU in 1985 and has essentially received every single important university service and teaching award that one can receive during his time here, including the Perrine Phi Beta Kappa Prize for teaching. He's also an Altshuler Distinguished Teaching Fellow. And he's also received the university's M Award, its highest award for service. He's also quite the scholar. In fact, I'm going to not look at him when I say this, because I will note that I first came to know Tom Nock, I think about 10 years before we met, because he has authored this book, which you may notice is very well worn. His first book on Woodrow Wilson is still, to my mind, the single best volume on Wilson's foreign policy that one could possibly find. And I have proof for this because I assigned it every semester well before I ever met Tom. So I encourage you, after you read about McGovern, go back and think some more about Wilson. He's hip these days. Today, we have the wonderful pleasure then of listening to Tom present on something which he has worked on for a while, longer than I think he wants me to say, and certainly it's going to be well worth it. This is only volume one of a two-volume series from Princeton University Press, and let me tell you, when the reviews came back from the press on this one, they were beyond over the top. They were pleased not only publish this book, but publish this book tomorrow, because it's that good. So please join me in welcoming our colleague, Professor Tom Nock.
Gosh. Well, thank you, Jeff. That's a very, very thoughtful introduction. I feel like I need to lower expectations, like I'm running in a primary, since I'm in the home turf, that sort of thing. But really, I want to say a couple things about the center and Jeff before I begin, because I really admire Jeff Engel for his tremendous work in establishing the Center for Presidential History and the work of Brian Franklin and Ronna Spitz as well. I think the CPH is one of the best things to happen to SMU in recent years, and I deeply value my association with it. I also want to say thanks to all of you for coming out to hear a talk about George McGovern. This is something I've been working on for quite a while, and it's kind of a large book, and so it was one of those difficult tasks to sort of boil things down for a lecture like this. I also want to say thanks, I forgot to say this, a special thanks to a couple of members of my family and several good friends and colleagues from other corners of the university who are with us today. But my talk is basically a kind of overview of The rise of a Prairie Statesman in the 1950s and 1960s to get him to 1968, which was a tremendous watershed year in American history, in the history of the Vietnam War, and in George McGovern's career. And I'm going to start with 68 and move back a little bit. On Saturday morning, August 10, 1968, with his wife and five children at his side, a 46-year-old first-term senator from South Dakota stood before the press in the Senate caucus room. This was barely 2 weeks before the National Convention in Chicago, and George McGovern was about to enter the race for his party's presidential nomination. He would not be standing there, though, but for the assassination of his good friend, his dear friend, really, Senator Robert Kennedy, in June in Los Angeles, right after he won the South Dakota primary and the California primary over his rival, Eugene McCarthy. McGovern had actually declined a chance to declare months earlier, and Bobby had told the New York Times that he would have stayed out if George had decided to get in. Now, urged on by Kennedy's bereft disciples and a draft McGovern movement, he stated his belief in Kennedy's twin goals, for which he'd more or less given his life, to end the war in Vietnam and to a commitment to heal the divisions in American society. "I have spoken out on the hard issues," the senator said. He was outlining his career for a few minutes since 1956. "If I have any special asset for national leadership, it is, I believe, a sense of history, an understanding of the forces that have brought this country to a position of power and influence, and an appreciation of what is important in our own time. For 5 years, I have warned against our deepening involvement in Vietnam. That war must be ended now, not next year or the following year, but now. It had thus far cost the lives of 25,000 GIs and $100 billion, and it was the Democrats' responsibility," he said, "to take to the American people a platform and leadership determined to reverse this grievous error. And that would require some scaling down of the military expenditures so the excess resources might be," he said, "diverted to our long neglected cities and the strengthening of rural America. Finally," he said, "we need to harness the full spiritual and political resources of the nation to put an end to shameful remnants of racism and poverty that still afflict our land. Just as brotherhood is the condition of survival in a nuclear world, so it is the condition of peace in America." Now, in Sunday papers all over the country, McGovern was front page news. Under the headline, "A Dove Who Flew Bombers," the New York Times profiled a shy and modest professor who speaks with a Western twang and who long ago demonstrated his willingness to accept tough challenges. The Washington Post pronounced him one of the most honorable and high-minded men in the Senate, whose opposition to the war was early and unwavering. Historian and Kennedy family advisor Arthur Schlesinger appraised him for the press this way: "A war hero, a scholar, a brave and eloquent senator, he has the breadth of experience, clarity of purpose, and the passion of a commitment to make a great president." Of course, no formal tribute, no matter how felicitous, could convey the fullness or assess the legacy of a career as significant as George McGovern's. And in my book on his life and times, I aim to tell a story that as yet has gone untold about a politician and statesman who never became president of the United States, but whose life and public service remains as compelling and instructive as any Cold War president. Indeed, none other than Lyndon Johnson once allowed, "McGovern's life composed, quote, a dramatic and inspiring story of what America is." You know, unlike any other Democratic presidential aspirant before or since, McGovern actually asked his fellow citizens to think critically about their country, in particular about American military interventionism in the Third World in the name of anti-communism, and about the amassing of a nuclear arsenal of such size as to threaten human existence. His position constituted an all-embracing rethinking of American internationalism and the original notion of the American century itself. Now, a lot of factors of biography naturally shaped his outlook on the world. He was the son of a Methodist minister, upbringing in a religious household in Mitchell, South Dakota during the Great Depression was undoubtedly the central influence on his early personal development, but the Great Depression itself, I think, ran a close second. One of McGovern's earliest memories at the age of 10 was of seeing a grown man cry. The incident occurred when George and his father paid a call on their friend Art Kendall, who was a hardworking local farmer, and as they drove up, Mr. Kendall sat sobbing on the back porch. In his hand, he held a check he had just received for his entire year's production of hogs, and the amount of the check didn't even cover the cost of shipping them to market. McGovern would see a lot of scenes like this. This was the first one of a farmer who received literally nothing for all of his effort, and it would stay with him forever. As for his formal early education, when he studied American history at Mitchell High School, he could not help but be impressed by the statesmen in his part of the country, and he especially admired some progressives like Robert La Follette and George Norris, who were both Republicans, who strove to lessen the burdens of farmers and laborers and small businessmen. He had a gifted history teacher named Bob Pearson, who encouraged him to go out for debate. And at length, McGovern would become a star debater renowned throughout all the Plains states, particularly after he matriculated to Dakota Wesleyan University, where he decided to major in history. And in a way, this probably is true for, well, I can think of one current politician, that debate becomes an introduction to politics. In honing his forensic skills, he immersed himself in the study of controversial events and subjects that defined his era of depression and of the war, in propositions like whether or not the country's railroads should be nationalized, or whether the United States and Great Britain should form a permanent alliance. Eventually, World War II would interrupt his education and his string of debate victories. In February of 1943, the Army Air Force called him to train as a B-24 bomber pilot. The B-24 was a big, sluggish, four-engine plane. It was dubbed the Liberator, and usually flight crews would dub it the Liquidator, or the Flying Coffin. Over Germany, Italy, and Australia, McGovern flew 35 combat missions, several of them as harrowing as could be. On one mission, when two of the four engines went out, he had to make an emergency landing on a very tiny island in the Adriatic that didn't have a proper landing strip. On their very last mission, which was over Linz, Austria, their Liberator sustained 67 hits from flak, which took out the nose cap, one of the engines, and all the hydraulics, and it climaxed in a crash landing, but no injuries. On 35 potentially fatal missions, he brought his crew back alive every time. And for his courage and skill, he was awarded the Distinguished Flying Cross with three oak leaf clusters. McGovern once recalled, "I really was carried away by the vision of Franklin Roosevelt, Winston Churchill, and the Four Freedoms and the United Nations." Returning home in 1945, he said he felt as if he was about to participate in the launching of a new day in world affairs. His wartime experiences tended to heighten his desire to study American history and international relations, and with the help of the GI Bill, he entered the PhD program at Northwestern. His professors included Ray Allen Billington, who was a famous historian of the American frontier, and Arthur Link, the great Woodrow Wilson biographer, whose devotion to the subjects of progressive reform and American internationalism would influence McGovern in quite conclusive ways. McGovern also admired the work of the progressive historians of the previous generation, practitioners like Frederick Jackson Turner and Charles Beard, who emphasized the role that conflict played in bringing about change in American history. And McGovern's dissertation topic in this sense is instructive too. It was about the Colorado coal strike of 1913-14, the second bloodiest labor upheaval in American history, a story of a kind of war that John D. Rockefeller Jr. conducted against the miners of Colorado. And this resonated for McGovern, because in part it reminded him of the folks in South Dakota who struggled against economic forces beyond their control. And so through the lens of his graduate history education, his view of politics and social conflict was beginning to crystallize. McGovern's academic studies engendered a preference for critical analysis. If one sought a better world, then one had to cultivate a serious sense of history in order to arrive at a useful understanding of American politics and foreign policy. In the latter field, he read kind of the first draft of the Cold War by writers such as Owen Lattimore, Theodore H. White, John K. Fairbank, whose works on Asia raised doubts in his mind already about the oncoming Cold War. There would have been no American intervention in Vietnam, he'd write as a senator, if the views of competent Asia scholars had been heeded. As a graduate student, he had reached the conclusion that much of the Cold War was the result, as he said to Arthur Link in a letter, the result of U.S. blundering and allegiance to reactionary regimes on the one hand, and Soviet stubbornness and opportunism on the other hand. In light of the Korean War and McCarthyism, he wrote, we seem to be unaware that two-thirds of the world is either in revolution or on the verge of it, which the Soviets exploited, of course, whereas we are engaged in a hopeless process of sitting on the lid in the tension centers of the world. By 1953, McGovern had earned his PhD and accepted a position to teach at his alma mater, but his teaching career only ran about 3 years or so because politics had become such an irresistible attraction for him. He resigned his tenure-track job to take up the task of reorganizing the then moribund Democratic Party of South Dakota. And a lot of his friends thought he'd lost his mind to give up a tenure-track job to organize Democrats in South Dakota. In 1952, the state had given Eisenhower a 2-to-1 margin over Adlai Stevenson and elected 108 Republicans to the 110-seat state legislature. Nonetheless, by 1956, McGovern somehow not only had revived competitive two-party politics, but also managed to win election to the House of Representatives. It was the first Democrat the state sent to Washington in 22 years. He didn't waste much time making his presence known on Capitol Hill, particularly in agriculture. And that was, of course, South Dakota's number one enterprise. Because commodity prices had fallen 16% since Eisenhower became president, McGovern offered an amendment to a major farm bill that would have established 90% parity payments. The amendment failed, but by just 4 votes, and the folks back home were duly impressed. McGovern in time would become a leading expert on agriculture with an emphasis on the family farm, and farmers would always play an important role in his political success in South Dakota. In his second year, a McGovern proposal did become law, and this had to do with federal aid to education, which is pretty controversial back in the 50s. Despite the baby boom and the dire shortage of classrooms, efforts on its behalf had gone nowhere until October 1957. That was when the Russians launched Sputnik, and that jolted the issue back to life. As a member of the Subcommittee on Education, McGovern learned some alarming things about the state of education at that time. To begin, most young people simply could not afford college, and that included half the students who ranked academically in the top percent in the nation. Less than half the country country's college teachers held doctorates. Half of America's high schools offered no foreign language classes, and only one out of three high school students studied chemistry, one out of four physics. In contrast, Russian high school students took 4 years of both math and science, and their school year ran 10 months, 6 days a week. And so McGovern therefore began his remarks on the House floor by quoting H.G. Wells, "Human history becomes more and more a race between education and catastrophe." The original National Defense Education Act would have provided federal loans for college students majoring in the sciences, but Professor McGovern argued that the nation would be far better served by extending those benefits to all students, regardless of major. America needed better science education, certainly, but it also needed, he said, well-educated men and women in all fields of knowledge if we were to survive and flourish. And after considerable debate, his amendment was adopted, and in August 1958, the House of Representatives passed the most important legislation of its kind to that point in U.S. history. It's because of initiatives like this, as well as attentive constituency work and a pleasing personality, McGovern won reelection in 1958, and apparently he had voiced the concerns of South Dakotans effectively enough so that they were willing to forgive him for even his criticism of Eisenhower's foreign policy. For example, McGovern voted against the Eisenhower Doctrine. That was a pledge to protect American oil interests in the Middle East through military aid or intervention. Some of its detractors called it a predated declaration of war. In the Third World, McGovern emphasized, for every dollar the U.S. spent on economic assistance, it spent $10 on military assistance in countries whose people often didn't have enough to eat and that often had rates of illiteracy as high, literally as 99%. Such a course, he believed, left untouched the swamplands of poverty and disease, the social, political problems, he said, that really threatened the region's peace. Do we build strength against communism, he wondered, by propping up rulers who embody everything that is alien to our traditions of liberty and equality? The real test for foreign aid, he said, ought to be how effectively it enables the people of the underdeveloped areas to build up the kind of society where better standards of life are possible. McGovern had embarked on a path from which he would rarely stray. By 1960, he was ready to challenge Carl Mundt, the powerful Republican incumbent for his seat in the Senate. In the November election, JFK would lose in South Dakota by 50,000 votes to Nixon, 50,000 votes out of 300,000. And McGovern would come within 15,000 of capsizing Mundt. So a lot of people were voting for Nixon and also for McGovern. As things turned out, though, defeat contained a rare opportunity. McGovern had rather impressed John F. Kennedy, and in January, he appointed McGovern director of Food for Peace. Food for Peace had the law that established Food for Peace come about in 1954, and the idea behind it was primarily to alleviate the burden of America's huge grain surpluses by distributing them abroad. And the Eisenhower administration got a lot of criticism for this because it came across as a kind of dumping program without much sensitivity for the economic needs of the recipient countries. And what McGovern did was to engineer a vast expansion of the program and turn Food for Peace into a dynamic tool of foreign policy. For 2 years, he traveled constantly, overseeing allotments of millions of tons of surplus American food and fiber that would be used, for example, as what he called self-help capital to fuel labor-intensive economic development projects. And in 20 undeveloped countries, Food for Peace would provide partial wage payments for about 700,000 workers engaged in things like land clearance and irrigation and construction of small hospitals and schools and that sort of thing. And for McGovern, this was the best way to fight the Cold War, by launching essential public works projects like this while also improving the nutritional health of millions of people, because the families of the workers got the food as well. Dearest to his heart, however, was the overseas school lunch program, which worked tirelessly to revitalize in about 20 countries, including South Korea, South Vietnam, Mexico, Brazil, Egypt, the Philippines, especially India. Among other things, his dedication resulted in dramatic improvements in school attendance by upwards of 40%, and in the health of literally now tens of millions of malnourished children in every part of the globe. And some good, you know, credit for the United States, goodwill for the United States coming with that too. McGovern had superintended, arguably, the single greatest humanitarian achievement of the Kennedy-Johnson era, and this experience would have a lasting impact on him about his thinking on the ways in which larger, more powerful countries, how they might figure in the life of weaker nations. He gave a lot of talks about Food for Peace in the United States as well, and he used to call it our most constructive instrument of foreign policy. Once, he said at a gathering in Aberdeen, South Dakota, that in the nuclear age, there is no longer any alternative to peace, and that alongside strengthening the UN at every point, America can make its greatest contribution to world peace by fully utilizing our agricultural abundance. And so this was kind of his way of engaging farmers on the Cold War by showing the interrelatedness of education and agriculture and foreign policy. And this, for him, was the right way to reckon with and prevail over the Soviets. He liked to point out that farmers in this country represented 8% of the population. And that 8% of the population produced five times the volume of agriculture that their counterparts in the Soviet Union produced, and 50% of the Soviet population worked in agriculture. So our 8% was five times more productive than half of the Soviet population. And then he'd say, after all, Marx was a city boy. So this was really quite a great success for McGovern. He got great publicity all over the country, but his heart really belonged in more direct politics. He really still longed to be a senator, and with JFK's blessings, he entered the race in 1962 in South Dakota and won. Something interesting about this particular period, starting in early 63, it's kind of an interlude between the missile crisis and the expansion of the war in Vietnam. And McGovern saw a kind of possible peace dividend. The prevailing state of international relations, he believed, held the possibility of curbing the nuclear arms race and trimming down America's colossal military-industrial complex, just by a gradual way, shift in the nation's economy toward more Pacific industrial enterprises. In 1963, he introduced extraordinary legislation to serve these ends. To begin, he proposed a $5 billion cut in defense appropriations for fiscal 1964. Defense appropriations stood at $54 billion then, or over half the entire federal budget. He made a very interesting case for pruning, emphasizing that the two superpowers together had amassed the equivalent of from 40 to 60 billion tons of TNT in their nuclear stockpiles, enough to kill virtually every living thing on the planet over and over again. And in light of such grotesque redundancy, he asked what possible advantage could accrue from appropriating additional billions of dollars to build more missiles and bombs. The time had come to reconsider national security needs alongside their implications for American society. This is 50 years ago, and this is when $1 billion was $1 billion, and that meant $1 million could buy a nice school or hospital. And so he said, what in this instance could a $5 billion savings mean? It would build a $1 million school in every one of the nation's 3,000 counties, plus 500 hospitals costing $1 million apiece, plus college scholarships worth $5,000 each to 100,000 students, and still permit a tax reduction of $1 billion. But this was just a half of it. In October of 63, the senator introduced his National Economic Conversion Act, counseling a coordinated effort between industry and government. The bill called for a presidential commission to identify any reasonable future opportunities for converting the instruments of war into the tools of peace. And here, systematic planning was the key, because it could at once relieve the anxieties of all concerned who had grown dependent on the gigantic WPA that the Pentagon had become. And he said it would add new force to disarmament discussions by removing fear of the economic consequences, and it could cause a boom rather than a drag on our economy. The current level of military spending, he argued, actually distorted the economy. It weakened the competitive position of the civilian industries and aggravated our balance of payments. Once ranked first, the United States recently had slipped to fifth place in machine tool production, while Japan and Western Europe were modernizing their civilian industrial plants at a far greater rate than we were. So a reordering of priorities, he thought, was kind of a matter of common sense. Chiefly because of Vietnam, McGovern's perception of a peace dividend was fleeting, yet he would always contend that the Cold War could not be won by military means alone. And ironically, in the speech in which he explained the benefits of a 10% cut in defense, he had referred to the current dilemma in Vietnam, as he called it, as a clear demonstration of the limitations of military power. The $54 billion budget apparently was no match for a ragged band of illiterate guerrillas fighting with homemade weapons against the tyrannical government in Saigon that existed only because the United States created and financed it. President Kennedy's policy, alas, was scarcely one of victory or even stalemate, he observed. Rather, it was a policy of moral debacle and political defeat. And he ended this, one of the very earliest trenchant commentaries by any senator on this subject, with a prophetic warning. The failure in Vietnam will not remain confined to Vietnam. The trap we have fallen into there will haunt us in every corner of this revolutionary globe if we do not properly appraise its lessons and rely less on armaments and more on the economic, political, and moral sources of our strength. In August of 1964, as the electoral contest between Lyndon Johnson and Barry Goldwater was commencing, McGovern voted in favor of the Gulf of Tonkin resolution. That was an open-ended authorization for military action for Johnson to take at will, and it was pretty politically motivated. McGovern voted for it, mainly for the sake of a great society, but nonetheless with great misgivings. He'd forever regret the vote. A mere 2 months after Inauguration Day, Johnson was no longer the peace candidate, as he had portrayed himself in order to defeat Goldwater, and CBS News invited McGovern to take part in a primetime televised debate. In response to his hawkish co-panelist, he denounced the idea of escalation and massive bombing as worse than futile, predicting a staggering loss of life out of all proportion to the stakes involved, and such enormous instability that indeed we invite a much worse situation than the one that exists. It would be far better, he said, for politicians to take some political risks for a negotiated settlement than for us to risk a course that might cost the lives of hundreds of thousands of our citizens. You know, as the Vietnam War unfolded, McGovern well understood that the engine that drove the war pretty much was domestic politics. That is to say, the repercussions of McCarthyism in tandem in this situation with Johnson's personal insecurities and his fear of a right-wing backlash at home, that would undermine his loftier ambitions. And in most respects, from Truman onward, no president was willing to permit or otherwise preside over an American military defeat in Vietnam. Initially, McGovern was not unsympathetic, and he tried to reason with Lyndon Johnson about this in private. On one occasion, for about a half an hour in the Oval Office, he endeavored to refute Johnson's article of faith that Ho Chi Minh was a surrogate of Red China. McGovern stressed the fact that Vietnam and China had been enemies for 1,000 years, literally, and that Ho Chi Minh was first and foremost a nationalist who might well serve as a barrier against Chinese expansion. And after a while, Johnson interrupted and said, "God damn it, George, I don't have time to be sitting around this desk reading history books." Nothing LBJ said that night reassured McGovern, and certainly not his boasts about his control over the bombing campaign or his powers of seduction in, and I'm quoting Johnson, in going up little Ho Chi Minh's skirt an inch at a time. In other endeavors, McGovern could be counted among Johnson's staunchest supporters. Their domestic aspirations were indistinguishable. No one embraced Johnson's civil rights or education legislation or Medicare more ardently than McGovern. To him, Lyndon Johnson was the authentic heir to FDR. But there was a fundamental difference. Johnson believed that in order to conduct his war on poverty, he must also fight communism in Southeast Asia. McGovern believed that in order to achieve a truly great society, the United States must refrain from, or at least curtail, military interventionism in the name of anti-communism. And in the case of Vietnam, it was utterly futile. About the bombing, he pointed out that the enemy, that is the Viet Cong, the insurgent guerrillas in the South, were part of the people and terrain, in many cases farmers by day, fighters by night. To bomb them, McGovern explained, is to bomb the women and children, the villagers and the peasants with whom they intermingled. To destroy their crops is to destroy the countryside on which the general population depended. And so to escalate this war, he warned, would only strengthen the guerrillas' cause in the eyes of the South Vietnamese and destroy the moral influence of the United States in Asia. Then there was the waste of precious resources. Does it make sense, he asked his colleagues, to use a $2 million plane carrying a $10,000 bomb bomb load to knock out a grass hut or a rope bridge that will be repaired by nightfall? Then too, on the ground, the U.S. upped the ante by 100,000 troops a year, 1965, 66, 67, while more than twice that number of Vietnamese came of age annually, and that was a perfect formula for stalemate. Meanwhile, by 1967, no country in the history of warfare had been subjected to more intensive air assaults than Vietnam. From March 1965 through December 1967, B-52s rained down upon Vietnam 1.5 million tons of bombs. 500,000 on the north, 1 million on the south, and that was a total exceeding the combined tonnage of bombs dropped by all the belligerents in World War II. By that point, most of North Vietnam's infrastructure lay in ruins. Napalm and Agent Orange had destroyed half of all Vietnam's forests. In the jungles, nearly 16,000 American soldiers had lost their lives and over 60,000 wounded, another 14,000 killed in 1968, and of course, Vietnamese deaths numbered in the hundreds of thousands. To accomplish these feats, the U.S. was spending about $2 billion each month, a sum exceeding the War on Poverty's budget for all of 1966. And still, the enemy's will to carry on the struggle seemed undiminished. And here at home, turmoil engulfed the United States on a scale not seen since the Civil War. By this point, McGovern had emerged as the leading critic of the war within the liberal establishment, which itself had conceived the war. In April 1967, in response to claims of light at the end of the tunnel, McGovern gave a momentous speech, The Lessons of Vietnam. Said Robert Kennedy, of all the speeches on that subject, this one had the greatest influence across the country. And in it, McGovern pronounced the conflict the most tragic, diplomatic, and moral failure in our national experience, a defeat for America, whether we win or lose. And if it did not end soon, our dreams of a great society and a peaceful world will turn to ashes. Only by a crude reading of history and a distortion of our most cherished ideals, he continued, could anyone really defend this war, which was essentially a civil conflict among various groups of Vietnamese. In any event, the challenge of communism could not be met by forcing an American solution on a people still in search of their own national identity. Above all, Americans must learn that conflicts of this kind have historical dimensions that are essentially political, economic, and psychological, and they do not respond readily to military force from outside. Moreover, corrupt regimes like the one in Saigon do not deserve to be saved by the blood of American boys. The Congress, he concluded, must never again surrender its power under our constitutional system by permitting an ill-advised, undeclared war, thus rendering its function very largely one of acquiescence. Well, the next year was among the worst in U.S. history. 1968 opened with the surprise Tet Offensive throughout South Vietnam. This caused a majority of Americans for the first time to doubt the wisdom of having gotten involved in the war in the first place. In March, Lyndon Johnson announced his withdrawal from politics. 4 days later, Martin Luther King was assassinated. Then in June, Kennedy. And in August, in Chicago, police and anti-war demonstrators clashed in the city's streets and threw the Democratic Convention into disarray. And in November, Richard Nixon was elected president. The Democrats' convention was disastrous for other reasons, too. McGovern had launched his campaign for the nomination mainly to help secure in the party's platform a plank calling for a bombing halt in Vietnam and the start of serious negotiations to end the war. But LBJ from the ranch on the Pertinalis was still in control. He crushed all hope for party harmony when he directly, personally thwarted a compromise peace plank that had the support of McGovern and Kennedy's people, Eugene McCarthy's people, and even that of Vice President Hubert Humphrey. Then there was this. Humphrey had not won a single primary, yet he copped the nomination because two-thirds of the delegates were chosen by tightly controlled state organizations, often in secret. Afterward, many Democrats felt that Humphrey's nomination and the peace plank's demise were due to a process that flaunted the very name of their party and did demand change. Of all the Democrats, only McGovern emerged from Chicago with an enhanced reputation. He has become a major force in American politics, said one major publication, an overnight star. Time magazine declared him one of the three most likely prospects for his party's nomination in 1972. And amazingly, perhaps a majority of South Dakotans had come to agree with him on the war. In his hard-fought reelection campaign for the Senate, 90% of the Democrats and 40% of the state's Republicans supported him for a 58% margin of victory. One of the state's Republican newspapers editorialized, he is the kind of man the future must have. In his second term, McGovern realized the most important domestic achievements of his term. First, as the chair of his party's commission to review the procedures, on delegate selection, he was instrumental in creating new rules that a majority of delegates would be chosen democratically through caucuses, such as the Iowa caucus, and more direct primaries. Then he made Americans aware of the fact that there was hunger in their midst and pushed through the most significant expansion of food stamps ever undertaken, quadrupled the scope of the program, and also doubled the availability of school lunches for the nation's poorer school districts. As for his most important legacy, he had already established its foundation by the time of his reelection. His great priority was to get the United States, was to get the country out of Vietnam as quickly as possible and to help Americans figure out how they had got there. In July, just before the Chicago Convention, he had written, "What would have happened if instead of sending 500,000 troops to Vietnam, we had sent 10,000 Peace Corpsmen, armed with medical ability, agricultural know-how, sanitation and nutrition skills, and dedicated teaching talent, and had left the Vietnamese to develop their political and economic institutions in their own way." In December, just before beginning his second term, McGovern contemplated what the future might hold in a plenary address at the American Historical Association convention in New York. "As a practicing politician, increasingly grateful for his own historical education," he said, "he believed that the quest for a more peaceful international community is the most crucial task of our age. It was also his conviction that the only potential gain that could come of Vietnam was the humility and wisdom that may guide us toward a more rational view of our future role in the international community. Vietnam should have taught us a new respect for caution and restraint in the exercise of military power abroad. The real issue," he said, "is whether the United States shall continue to intervene unilaterally in the affairs of other states, as we have done during the 1960s, or will we seek to move away from this go-it-alone approach toward a greater measure of international cooperation based on a respect for the world's diversity." He could not have guessed it, but he put his finger on one of the core problems of American foreign policy that would endure into the 21st century. His next campaign, 4 years hence, would become the unique highlight of a life's work driven by a relentless sense of duty to explore alternatives to the ideas and institutions that forged the American century and Cold War globalism. The propositions he would ask his fellow citizens to consider would hold implications not only for interventionism in the Third World, but also for the armaments race and the use of force in international relations, the political economy of the United States relative to other industrial powers, and not the least, for the very nature of their country's political and social institutions. With an enduring faith in the possibilities for national redemption through authentic internationalism, education, and humanitarian endeavor, George McGovern would beckon, "Come home, America." Thank you all. Thank you. And very sweet. Thank you so much. Q&A, huh? Yes.
We have a couple microphones for you, so if you have a question, please raise your hand and we'll get one to you.
I left you speechless.
I'll open up with a question.
There's one there.
So there's clearly a great respect, some level of respect that you have for Mr. McGovern. I'm wondering if you might give us something that you would see as a weakness in his political career, something that even he might have, you know, regretted later.
Well, he made a mistake of letting in the convention of 72, letting the nominations for vice president go on too long into the night. So he gave his acceptance speech at 2 in the morning, and it was really a great speech and well-delivered, but it was prime time in Guam. Perhaps that convention was a little bit too open. That certainly was a mistake. And I'll tell you something else. Probably a lot of presidential candidates have been guilty of choosing not exactly the best possible running mate. That certainly was the case with McGovern as well, although, you know, Richard Nixon had Spiro Agnew. In the case of McGovern, Tom Eagleton. That was a case of concealed mental instability. He had a history of electroshock treatments, that sort of thing, manic depression. And his big dilemma was whether to try to ride it out or get Eagleton off the ticket. And right away, the finance director said, you know, the donations are drying up, and, you know, the Nixon administration was ready to say, do you want a man who suffered manic depression a heartbeat away from the nuclear button, that sort of thing. So that was a terrible, terrible dilemma, and that really, really put the kibosh on that campaign. So he certainly isn't perfect. I don't know if I quite... Go ahead.
So my question is, regarding, so McGovern is very anti-Vietnam War, it also comes with a focus on importance of social welfare policy and expenditure in the United States.
Right.
My question is, what was his position to other U.S. intervention or military presence in other places like Japan, South Korea, or Europe?
Sure.
Probably it was not so divisive or controversial at that time because of the Cold War, but
right.
Does he have any position for those like a U.S. military presence?
Well, yes. He was not terribly enthusiastic about the Korean War, in part because in many of those situations we're propping up a different kind of dictator, that sort of thing. Although he thought Truman did relatively well, and he applauded the firing of MacArthur. That's what turned the Korean War into such a grinding stalemate and something of a disaster politically for Truman. He was certainly a critic, as a lot of Democrats and some Republicans were, of Lyndon Johnson's intervention in the Dominican Republic in the autumn of 1965. A lot of people ask a question like that because they assume, and maybe I don't want to put words in your mouth, but they assume that George McGovern was a pacifist. He really wasn't a pacifist. He, you know, believed in a deep sense of patriotism about the United States, but he was critical about these kinds of interventions and wanted the United States to be a little more creative in the kind of intervening it did in third world countries. And that so many times this was counterproductive to American interests. Those would be the two I can think of offhand where, you know, he had somewhat ambivalent feelings about rather than absolute certitude about the Vietnam War.
The media is really about my question. In this year's campaign race, the media has lost all pretense of being unbiased. So it's quite obvious everyone's biased. And we like to think back at this time, the 60s and all, that the media was very unbiased. Was that really true? And how much media influenced what McGovern did, said, and reacted to it?
Well, I'll tell you one thing about the media in the 60s and the Vietnam War. There's a rather misunderstanding about the role of the media in the Vietnam War. It was really very, very supportive of the Vietnam War during the first 3 or 4 years of it. It's a Tet Offensive that kind of turned things around. The Tet Offensive is January of 68, when there was supposed to be light at the end of the tunnel, and this was a multi-pronged offensive on the part of the Viet Cong in the South, aided by the North, against most of the provincial capitals. And it's the thing that caused Walter Cronkite to turn against the war. Many of you probably know that story, that line of Johnson, that when he lost Walter, he lost the war. So the press was really pretty fair in its coverage of that. In the 72 campaign, which my book doesn't address, McGovern couldn't get any traction on Watergate, in part because the media and Americans in general simply didn't believe the president had anything to do with it. How could he possibly have done this? Only Walter Cronkite, as it happens, into the fall began more probing journalism about Watergate, but still it wasn't going to go very far until well after the election and the Senate Watergate Committee. The story of the year in 1972 was the Eagleton affair. And I don't think the press was overly harsh on McGovern. They reported what the situation was, and it wasn't a very pretty scene. They weren't particularly tough on Nixon at that time, in part because Nixon sort of kept a relatively low profile for a presidential candidate because he knew he didn't have to do very much because the circumstances were so dire for McGovern. It's interesting. People look at McGovern mostly because of the huge loss in 1972, but prospectively, he had run, most political scientists think he ran a brilliant primary campaign for the most part, and up to June of 1972, the Nixon White House was really scared to death of McGovern because he had integrity going for him, the underdog status, that sort of thing, and a Harris poll put him within 5 points of Nixon, and another one about 6 points. This is in June. And then comes July with that convention that really did him in. And Eagleton somehow was able to twist that situation so that he looks like the victim. And you know, his wrongdoing really was concealing his situation. He was asked directly by Frank Mankiewicz, anything we have to worry about, Tom? Any skeletons in the closet? And you know, he lied about it, and that set McGovern up for a hard time, no matter what he did, that the press was going to really focus in on.
Are we ever going to learn? I mean, how many times do we have to do this?
Well, I don't know.
She's referring to a lecture series?
Yeah. I don't know. I hope not. I wonder myself. I think that's really the most valuable legacy of George McGovern's career is this kind of prophetic warning, and the virtues of thinking critically about what your own country does. He was often accused of not being patriotic enough, but there are a few presidential candidates who showed the kind of bravery and courage under fire as he did. Bob Dole will tell you that. Bob Dole one time said to me when I interviewed him, he said, "I don't know, George must have known something the rest of us didn't, because he was sure right about Vietnam." But I once ran across a line of Robert Frost's when he said, "The better part of patriotism is not to wrap oneself in the flag. The better part of patriotism is to sustain a lover's quarrel with one's country." And maybe that's part of the legacy there. It's because it is there. It's possibly unclaimed, but it's there, I think, and it's intrinsic value and tangibles too.
There's several back here.
How would you describe your personal interactions with Mr. McGovern? What was it like to work with him on this book?
Well, he was very easy to work with, in part because he was a historian for a while, and very, very forthcoming. I had my first interview with him in Washington and my second interview with him here at SMU when he and William F. Buckley were traveling around a kind of dog and pony show with Edward P. Newman in the Tate series he came. Actually, your husband provided his office for me when I interviewed McGovern, but I must have had 20 or 25 interviews with him over the years, so I have quite a corpus of transcripts and about 100 other interviews with various senators and friends and family members and so on, and of course a lot of research in his papers, which something like 850 linear feet of manuscripts there at Princeton University. But very, very forthcoming, and I think he had a sense of detachment about his mistakes as well as his achievements. I can't remember if you might have met him, Patty, when he was here a second time in 2004. I always like to ask this question, what is wrong with a university that has George McGovern come to speak on the Thursday before the 2004 election and George W. Bush come on the Monday before the 2004 election? And the answer is not a thing. George McGovern was a great person to get to know and to write this book about.
So as you mentioned, George McGovern was one of the authors of the modern primary system and used his knowledge of it to win the nomination of his party in the first election of that modern primary system.
Yes.
I was wondering if later on in his career he had any expressed any strong opinions about the way that process that he helped create turned out in subsequent elections, if he expressed any regrets.
That's a good question. I don't think so, and in part because what happened with those reforms was this. It opened things up. Neither of the parties really chose their, believe it or not, their candidates all that democratically. About two-thirds of the delegates in both parties were chosen pretty much by bosses or local folks. They didn't have to announce when and where those meetings took place or anything like that. And at the, this started with the Democrats in 1964 with the Mississippi Freedom Democratic Party, when Mississippi refused to seat any black delegates, and they worked out a kind of compromise where two black people could be in the delegation with a promise of reforms to come in 68, which didn't come. In 1968's Democratic Convention, 2% of the people there of the delegates were African American, 14% were women, and I forget what the number was of people under 30. With the reforms by 1972, it was 36% women and something like 18% African American, and I can't remember, a very high proportion now, a greater proportion of young people as well. So these reforms opened up the system so that if you've ever caucused, it's really a great experience. The Iowa caucus and all these other primaries came about because of those reforms, and the Republican Party adopted them eventually too. This actually started back long before our modern times. It started in the progressive era. We adopted the Australian ballot back then, election reforms, so you had secret ballots. You had the 17th Amendment to the Constitution, ratified in 1913. It was the first time you ever got direct election of senators. They were always chosen by state legislatures. And in 1912, that's the race where you have Wilson, Taft, and T.R. and Debs, Theodore Roosevelt ran in all seven primaries that existed there. He was challenging Taft to get back the Republican nomination. He won all seven, including Taft's Ohio, but still, Taft in those 4 years was able to get control of the party apparatus and win the nomination. That caused TR to form that third party. So this is a kind of issue that has a longer context to it. I know what you're getting at today with the situation today, the way our politics have become a bit circus-like, at least this year, but I'm not sure that the openness of primaries and caucuses is really the problem. I want to go with that.
Yeah. One of the things that I am thinking about in this election is the number of people who argued that they are angry voters, and perhaps no population was as angry as the group that he must have met between his entry into national politics and on the political scene all the way from 63 to 72. Can you get any insight about how he responded to the angriness of the American voters and the divisiveness that was tearing us apart back then?
That's a good question. Thanks, Rita. By 1967-68, the Vietnam War was not the number one issue. It was crime. It was the beginning of white blue-collar backlash against the Great Society and civil rights and all of that. And so that's a certain kind of anger that started to come to the fore and fueled George Wallace's third-party candidacy in 1966. He got about 10% of the vote in that. Richard Nixon tapped into that a bit also in his Southern strategy, as you as you know. In the case of McGovern, it's a different kind of anger from a different constituency. Younger people, in particular, were disturbed about the war. By, you know, if you look at 1965, in January and February, when just a small handful, maybe a dozen senators and one or two people in the House are starting to talk critically, that's a pretty early time, about the war. It's before the big escalation. By the time you get to late 67 into 68, it's a growing number of more establishment people, so that the Democratic Party, by time of the convention, is a 60-40 party. 60% want to stay the course with Johnson. 40% are really angry. And it's not just kids. When they debated that peace plank, you have Pierre Salinger standing up on a chair yelling, and you have that incident between Abe Ribicoff when he puts McGovern's name in nomination, and he looks right at Mayor Daley, whose police are out clubbing the anti-war demonstrators, saying, and with George McGovern in the White House, we wouldn't have Gestapo tactics in the streets of Chicago, and the place went crazy with that. So it was a combination of those factors. I think the war was the principal one, in part because of its repercussions for American society. Whereas, you know, if you spend $2 billion a month on that, and that's the equivalent to an entire year's budget for the war on poverty, or if that 2 months, or that $2 billion in 1 month, is the equivalent to the total of $2 billion that the Russians and the Red Chinese gave in aid to North Vietnam that entire 3 or 4 year period of Lyndon Johnson. You see what I'm getting at? All those resources wasted on that terrible situation, and the United States falling apart politically, the inner cities problems, all that. And I think most scholars, an awful lot of scholars of the war on poverty, think that its problem was not that Johnson would have said, in retrospect, I guess it went too far too fast, but actually part of the situation that caused the upheaval on the part of African Americans themselves was it was too slow, it was too little, too late, and that the outcome might have been better if the war on poverty was sustained longer and in a far more generous way. So you have a lot of anger in the country building up in different constituencies. At the same time, I think the inner dynamic in this might have been the war itself, the frustration from it.
Okay. One more question. If we could back up just a bit to Thomas Eagleton. I remember wondering at the time, and I still wonder, why there wasn't a better background check. It seems
could
to
you
me
say that a little louder? I'm sorry.
Why there wasn't a better background check on his health specifically. And, you know, I can kind of understand why FDR was reelected when everybody knew he was in very poor health. But Kennedy was also obviously in very poor health. And I just wonder if today we've learned anything from that experience, because we've all seen our country inherit a president.
Sure, sure. Well, in terms of a candidate's health, I'm not sure when that became the practice, that a candidate usually reveals the doctor's report if there's any serious issue like FDR's or Kennedy's. FDR's, Henry Wallace was the vice president during the war, and he was a bit too far left for most Democrats, and most Democrats were worried that FDR wouldn't survive a fourth term, and that's pretty much why we got Harry Truman. On the issue of selecting a running mate, as I was saying before, Richard Nixon didn't do a very good job either. Spiro Agnew was taking cash in envelopes as governor of Maryland, and continued to take it while he was vice president. And he got tripped up because the FBI was following him, and they nailed him for income tax evasion. And he resigned nulla contendere without, you know, being prosecuted. So that's not a very good record. And in the case of McGovern, as I say, some of this owed to the confusion of that convention. things got a little bit better in 76. I don't know if there's a lot of you here, I think, who probably remember 76 pretty well, and some who do not. But Jimmy Carter really made a virtue out of vetting about six or seven candidates quite carefully, including Walter Mondale, who was pretty squeaky clean. But still, you know, don't want to end on this particular note, but I can think of a candidate not too terribly long ago who might have done a better job selecting a running mate.
Well, I said that was going to be the last question, but you and I had a bet earlier that a certain question was going to be asked, and I said it was, so I have to ask it to make sure I win the bet.
Okay.
Which is that here we have an idealistic Democrat who is railing against the system, if you will, saying we need to question our assumptions, and he is particularly popular with the younger set of Democrats. Is there a Bernie Sanders analogy to be made here? And is that suggestive of a potential result of a Sanders candidacy?
Maybe. I guess, I think Tom Brokaw and Cokie Roberts kind of set this in motion. And I think Cokie Roberts is definitely a Hillary person. There is a kind of parallel. I mean, if you look at the war issue, the second war in Iraq, Bernie voted against it, Hillary for it, and I think the analogy that Cokie Roberts was striving for was McGovern versus Ed Muskie. Ed Muskie had been Humphrey's running mate in 68 and did very, very well, and he didn't do so well in the primary situation. People thought he would have done a better job as a candidate. He may well have, but he was very slow in coming to that issue on Vietnam. Obama voted against the war as well. McGovern endorsed him, incidentally, in 2008, much to the Clintons' chagrin. I don't know. The situation then, as opposed to today, is so much different today. This is really, I think, even stranger than 1972, because I think anything can happen. Whether or not Bernie might win, who knows? So might the other fellow in the Republican Party. That would be quite an amazing situation. But part of that question is driven by this, and that is the a kind of narrow perspective on the outcome of the election. And that's why I was stressing before that up to the convention, McGovern was doing extremely well. In retrospect, and here we have both parties are putting out fresh horses. In the case of 72, you have an incumbent. And I think in retrospect that Nixon was probably unbeatable in 1972. It could have been Humphrey, it could have been Muskie, but here's the thing. By the summer of 1972, Vietnam was really no longer a serviceable issue for a Democrat like McGovern. Nixon came in, there was about 540,000 troops in Vietnam, in South Vietnam. By the summer of 72, we're down to about 40,000. Reduced at 95%. And then earlier in 72, in February, it was a trip to China, and then the beginning of detente with the Soviet Union that summer. So he was really a formidable candidate in retrospect. McGovern, I don't know, McGovern maybe might have carried 8 or 10 states or 12 maybe the way the caucus did. The caucus didn't really do all that badly against H.W. Bush compared to other Democrats of that period. So that's, I think, a reasonable analysis of that, that it's driven in part by the assumption that the loser factor in this. I think it's possible today that somebody like Bernie could win. If the Republicans can win with,
Well, it just goes to show that the secret to all political success is to choose your opponent well.
That's right. Yeah. That's so. Right. And that I tell Brian that that's a real shortcoming of George McGovern. He did not choose his opponent well in Richard Nixon.
Well, he has certainly chosen his biographer well.
Yeah. Oh, so. Thank you. Thank you very much.